Rape and marriage, martial or other relationship between a perpetrator victim cannot be a rape defense. A relationship between two individuals, including marriage, is built around love, respect, trust, and consent. So, a relationship between two individuals, we usually call it as a marriage, and a marriage is based upon totally based upon consent, love, trust, and many other reasons. And an action like rape has no place in a marriage, because as I said, marriage only happens because of true love, and etc. But especially in India, in our country, many rapes have been happening, and no one knows the reasons why the rape rate is so high in India. Seen in that context, the Supreme Court's latest query to a Maharashtra government employee asking whether he would marry a girl he was accused of raping repeatedly while she was a minor is intensive to the core. So given that context, means with this information or with this introduction, now we can start the right topic. And topic is that the Supreme Court's latest query or the latest mission, latest job was that first the case was that there was a man who was raping a girl, a minor, repeatedly, and then she cased the file, and this became a huge issue. He was called to the Supreme Court, and he was asked to marry the girl, and he was just asked, and there was no reply for him, and there was no reply from him, and all of this in this situation is just so unfortunate, and it's very even sad to hear about. By offering marriage as a solution to the rape victim, the judicial failed to protect the rights of a girl. So here the thing is that if the Supreme Court wants the man to marry the minor that he raped so many times, what's the use? If he marries her, he's going to do it again. There's no use of letting him marry him. Instead, the Supreme Court should give him some kind of punishment, or if the situation even escalates, the Supreme Court could even have the right of killing him. Instead of meeting out harsh punishment, the court asked the lawyer representing the accused to find out whether his client would be willing to marry the victim or risk going to jail. So as I said, the same thing again. Here the Supreme Court had granted no sort of harsh punishment, and all it wanted is that the man should be marrying the minor. And it just makes no sense, because if he marries her, she is going to do it again. Equal rights activists have always worked hard against misogyny, patriarchal mindsets, and other failings, such as blaming the victim for rape. So, the equal rights activists. So these activists, they were always active against three types of cases, against patriarchal cases, they are highly involved in the cases which include a person being against the country, and second is the case of misogyny, means the cases in which people behave in an abusive way towards women, or say something very bad about women, or hate women, or in that order. And the third one, another fallings such as blaming the victim for the rape. So this is the case that we have right now, and they involve in this case highly. This adverse battle for equality becomes even more difficult when people in high offices make offensive remarks. So suppose, as I said, in this case, someone raped a minor. So he's obviously situated at an higher authority when compared to the woman. So these situations of rapes, they have been happening very frequently in India. I think in this month we have encountered two or more editorials which told us about the problems of rape and marriage, and this is the continuation of it. So no one knows the reasons why this is especially high in India. On Monday, the Chief Justice of India, CJI, Sharad Bobde, told the lawyer of the rape accused, We are not forcing you. The lawyer later told the court that his client refused to marry the girl because he was already married. So here what basically happened is that, as I gave you all the context, that the judge of the Supreme Court, he asked the accused or the person who was believed to rape the minor frequently, the Supreme Court asked him to marry the girl. And he said to his lawyer that, the accused, he said to his lawyer that, no, I won't be marrying that girl as I am already married to another woman. In his petition, the accused recounted the allegations that he sexually abused the girl since he was in high school, and also that he had threatened the minor. So in some time, even more evidence came out. The evidence was that he was raping the girl, not just from a few years ago, but since he was studying in high school. So from that time, he has been frequently raping her. In another case, the bench stayed the arrest of a man accused of rape and after falsely promising marriage. The victim said she was promised marriage and was brutally sexually abused. So now coming to the perspective of the victim said that initially both of us decided to marry, but then he sexually and very violently raped me. The CJ asked the girl's lawyer, when two people are living as a husband and a wife, however brutal the husband is, can you call sexual intercourse between them rape? In both cases, these crimes attract severe penalties under the Criminal Law Amendment Act 2013. So now coming to the lawyer of the accused. Now, as we know the statement of the victim, who said that he has been raping me very abusively since I was in high school, promising me a marriage. He raped me. And now coming to the matter of the lawyer of the accused, he's saying that suppose that he is a husband and she is a wife. Now both of them are married. Now if they have sexual intercourse, can we call it as a rape? Is that really a rape? So he defends his client. He defends the accused in this way. But supposing that both of them are husband and wife, even his abusive actions attract a lot of penalties. On martial rape, though the recommendation was not included in the act, the Justice J.S. Verma committee was clear that the law ought to specify that a martial or another relationship between the perpetrator and the victim cannot be a defense against the sexual violence. And the court has made very clear that even though both of them were husband and wife, his abusive behavior is not defense in any kind of way. Citing the judgment of the European Commission of Human Rights in CR versus UK, it endorsed the conclusion that a rapist remains a rapist regardless of his relationship with the victim. In Shimbu and Nair versus the state of Haryana in 2013, the Supreme Court said the offer of a rapist to marry the victim cannot be used to reduce the sentence prescribed by the law. And here is the thing: the Supreme Court it is maybe doing this because in a case which happened in Shimbu, in a case of Shimbu and Anar versus the state of Haryana, which took place in 2013. Here there was a specific law or a provision that said that even though the Supreme Court asks a particular individual who raped a minor or any other woman to marry her, and if he marries her, that marriage it provides him defense. Even though he's married to that girl, he will get the punishment that he deserved. So basically, what I'm trying to say is that by marrying the girl that he raped, his punishment won't be reduced at any cost. When the scars of the Nirbhaya case are still raw and a series of rape and murders are being reported against minors, especially Dalits, in Uttar Pradesh, the judiciary's shocking remarks echo a deep-set prejudice against gender equality. The law should deliver justice, not blatantly tilt the scales against women's right. So, the author concludes this with saying that these types of rapes are happening very frequently in India, especially to Dalits, and that too in Uttar Pradesh. So he's also saying that the Supreme Court, it should not give the accused or the one who was believed to rape the girl to just go away or to just escape from the punishment of the Supreme Court by giving him a chance to marry her. Instead, it should take some serious action against him and should not let him marry the girl, and should support the protection rights of a woman. Thank you.